This is the Angry Game Master, and this is Angry Plays Sonic the... Oh, wait, no, we're not doing Sonic the Hedgehog tonight. We're taking a week off Sonic the Hedgehog to do something a little bit different, or at least it's going to be a little different if your only experience with me is Angry Plays Sonic the Hedgehog. But if you hung out with me before Angry Plays Sonic the Hedgehog, when Angry played actual interesting things that he liked, this will be nothing new to you. Actually, we're going to be looking at Maniac Mansion as a tie-in to this week's article on theangrygm.com, where I talked about how every adventure is a dungeon adventure based on the structure. So we're going to go back and look at Maniac Mansion, a game that has a lot of historical significance. And there's not going to be a lot of shrieking and screaming and dying. I am going to show off some dying here, because I'm going to kind of give a little bit of a tour of this game, and we're going to talk about the development of Maniac Mansion, we're going to talk about some of the lessons that came out of Maniac Mansion, and we're going to talk a little bit about RPG adventure design. So, if you're looking for me screaming and dying and cursing at Shadow the Hedgehog, that'll be next week. So, Maniac Mansion was published in 1987 by LucasArts Games, and that was back when LucasArts did more than just milk the, or basically squeeze the last dried, dusted powder out of the teat that is Star Wars. This is a game that in a lot of ways sort of defined what LucasArts was going to be, what LucasArts would make kind of its name for itself doing. This game was created by Ron Gilbert and Gary Winnick. I'm getting remarks about the stream buffering. It's a still image of a Commodore 64 screen, for God's sake. How could it be buffering? I don't know. Anyway, so this is a game that was, in a lot of ways, it was groundbreaking. I'm getting reports that the stream is dead. I'm not seeing that myself. Maybe refresh your streams. I have a good stream here. So, yeah, okay. So, and before I launch into the actual playthrough, I'm actually going to show off a couple of different versions of the game just briefly to talk about the different ports of the game, because the fact that it was so easily ported was one of the innovations that this game introduced. But let's just jump into it, and then we'll talk more about different things as they come up. So you are looking at the original version of the game, which was released on the Commodore 64 computer, like I said, back in 1987. It came on both sides of a single floppy disk, which means the entire game was 320 kilobytes. That's KB, not MB or GB. And the game begins. This is pretty much when you started up the game. This is what you saw, was a kid select screen. And the way the game... that was the lead into the game. So you were instructed to select two other kids because you would play three out of the seven kids, which led to some unique features too. But you always bring Dave in your party. He is Sandy's boyfriend and organizer of the rescue effort, which you can see at the top of the screen. His girlfriend Sandy, the cheerleader, has been kidnapped by Dr. Fred Edison, who dwells in the Maniac Mansion, and he and two of his friends are going to go and rescue her. Along with him, you can bring two more kids. So we have Sid, an aspiring musician trying to start his own new wave band. We have Michael, award-winning photographer for the college newspaper. And then we have Wendy, wants to be a famous novelist and is waiting for a big break. Bernard, president of the physics club and winner of the college's geek award. Razor is the lead singer for the punk band Razor and the Scumettes. And finally, Jeff usually hangs out on the beach, responds to the name Surfer Dude. So between the punk, the new age, and the Surfer Dude, you can kind of tell that this was definitely a product of the late 80s. Many of the characters were supposedly based on people that Ron Gilbert knew. I think Razor was based on Gary Winnick, the artist's girlfriend at the time, whose name was Ray. Wendy was based on someone who worked in the Lucasfilm studios. I believe she was an accountant, actually. Anywho, I'm just going to grab two kids and get started, because this is not the version we're going to be playing. And enjoy that wonderful Commodore speaker sound. And the awesome theme song. Darabin says he approves of the choices of Razor and Bernard. I have to say, I always chose Razor and Bernard when I played as a kid. Ooh, that's really piercing in my headphones. Go ahead and play the volume on that. I always chose Bernard and Razor, and according to the sequel Day of the Tentacle, Bernard at least was canonical as one of the three. And then we get the actual opening to the game. So what that shows is that 10 years ago, a meteor crashed on the grounds of the mansion. Okay, Darabim is saying that the game volume is a little loud. Okay, how's that? Okay, how's the game volume now? The sound of crickets. I'm not actually going to stick with this version for too long. I just want you to see it for its historical value. I am talking now. So this was the first point-and-click adventure game, and I don't mean that hyperbolically. And, you know, I'll get into that a little bit more as I start playing a real playthrough. But the basic game is point-and-clicky. You're in control of three heroes. You can use these various verbs along the bottom of the screen to walk around and interact with the environment. You begin outside the strange mansion. You can also switch kids, so we can switch to Razor and be in control of Razor. And I'll go ahead and just ring the bell, so that we can meet one of the people in the... So this is push doorbell. Now, even though this was a point-and-click adventure game, this was before the mouse was used. The mouse was a thing, actually. So this was actually designed to be used with a Commodore 64 joystick, which actually moved really, really slowly. Using it with the mouse, it was much better. But that is, if you ring the doorbell, Weird Ed Edison, thinking that his package has arrived, will come to the door. And so, that's the Commodore 64 version. Whoops. Yep, and there he comes out the door and sends you away. So that's the Commodore 64 version. And it did reasonably well, all things considered. But the version that really put the game on the map was the Nintendo version. Even though it's kind of infamous for how much was cut and edited from it. So this is the Nintendo version, and I'm just gonna show that off for a minute, and then we'll move on to the final version and we'll play the game for reals and talk about the game. It's a similar intro. It actually gives you the intro before it asks you to pick your kids. And you get that rockin' 8-bit NES soundtrack. And I had actually toyed with playing this version of the game, because the music in this version of the game, insofar as it's, you know, 8-bit chiptunes, is absolutely fantastic. The inhabitants of the house all have this theme that plays through the Edison theme, and it's great. The problem is, it's really slow because you have to use the NES controller. And you can see it's got the game. Okay. Alright, I was told that the music was drowning me out. How is it now? Whoops. I really miss the auto-ducking of my Elgato. Alright. You're gonna get an echo for a second. I'm turning it up so that I can hear the... Alright. Testing. Am I audible at all? Alright, well, this is the NES version. I'm just gonna very briefly show it off. I really can't. Alright. Gonna boost my microphone a little bit. And. Alright, how's this now? Alright, how is it now? I boosted my volume a little bit, and I've got the game audio turned down about as low as I really can. Once I switch over to the deluxe version, it'll be just fine. But, so we're gonna pick two kids again. And you can see that we get basically the same opening scene. What you'll notice, though, is that each kid has a theme song and begins the game with a CD player in their inventory, which is where their theme song comes from. I kid you not. Okay, so dialogue. Okay, I skipped the dialogue there. So again, you control this with the NES controller, but you can see that the game is basically the same. You can actually turn off the CD player. Darabim says the moon is huge. They must have tsunami-level tides. And we'll go ahead and we'll push the doorbell just one more time. This song... That is the Edison theme song, named for the family. And it is absolutely fantastic. Okay, that is the main reason why I considered playing this game. But they made a lot of cuts and they made a lot of changes, and the gameplay is really, really slow because of the slow movement of the arrow and having to use the NES pad. So... Yeah, also, for whatever reason, Darabim just observed, the entire Edison family is blue. And I don't know why. They're all blue. Him, Nurse Edna, and Dr. Fred. But, so that's the NES version. And this version sold really well. And this version is the reason why most people even know that Maniac Mansion existed. Because otherwise the computer version, the Amiga and the Commodore 64 version, didn't sell very well. Then the game got widely ported. And eventually, years later, where is it? There we go. A group of fans got together and remade the game with remade graphics and a slightly cleaned up interface based on the sequel. And this is the version that I'm going to be playing. And it is completely true to the original. The dialogue has not been changed. The graphics have been updated, but they are still, otherwise, completely original. And now we're going to start playing for real. And now the choice of the kids actually changes the game in that each kid has one or two unique puzzles or special ways to get through to the end of the game. Whoops. Is there... Whoa! I never left it on long enough to see that there was an intro screen. Let's just check this out. Holy crap. And I really do love this version. This version is really well done. Here's where Sandy was held captive and where we... I guess. How much of the game is he gonna spoil, though? This is interesting. I've never watched this before. Is he teaching you how to play the game? Alright. Alright, forget it. We'll watch that at the end. Okay. And... anyway, so each kid has a unique skill, and you can see that they're still the same kids, and each one has different ways of beating the game. So I'm going to go ahead and put this up to the chat. So we've got Sid the musician, the New Age musician, we've got Michael the photographer, we've got Wendy the novelist, Bernard the geek, Razor the punk, and Jeff the surfer dude. So, who would you like to accompany Dave on the journey here? Because I'm not going to play through it 7 times to get all the different endings. Actually, there aren't really 7 different endings. Hey, stop it now. Okay, so I've seen 2 votes for Bernard, 2 votes for Razor, a vote for Jeff. Though, actually, I've heard Ron Gilbert give a couple of interviews, and he's very, very... he pronounces the O in Razor very, very clearly. It's Razor, not Razor. I've always called her Razor, though. All right, so looks like we're going to go with Bernard and Razor, which is actually the group that I always kind of beat the game with myself. All right, and now we get the intro one more time. 20 years ago today. Sound still okay? O-Dog says, Razor the Barbarian. So the design of the mansion itself was Gary Winnick did all of the art in this game, and he said that the mansion itself was based on the mansion at Skywalker Ranch, which is where, you know, George Lucas had, he basically built this whole, like, ranch compound to house his companies. And I think at the time, LucasArts was in a place called the Stable House. But the main house was that big Victorian-looking, you know, multiple-story house. And that's where George Lucas had his offices and where the main offices were. And Gary Winnick says that the mansion itself was based on that design. Gary, you know, and I'm also going to say this right off the bat, Gary Winnick and Ron Gilbert had become very good friends while they were working at LucasArts, and they were basically given free rein to design this game. And while this game is sort of a beloved cult classic and a lot of people really love it, the fact of the matter is that in many ways it's a very flawed game. And Ron Gilbert actually admits that. And it laid a lot of groundwork for future games, but in itself it was kind of a mess. And, you know, and I'm going to talk about Ron Gilbert did a couple of, he's written a couple of articles about this game since. But so we have a similar interface as before. The verb list is a little bit more limited. O-Dog is asking about Tuna Head. Darabim says it's a little known fact that the family that the Luke George Lucas is actually blue in real life. Yeah, that's true. Shazba likes Razor's way of thinking. O-Dog, there's sort of an interesting story about the whole Tuna Head thing. It originally, hi, save load repeat. Originally, Ron Gilbert had scripted it so that Dave would tell Bernard, "Don't be a shithead." And one of the producers at LucasArts kind of nixed that. They said, "You can't say shithead in a LucasArts game." And, you know, Gilbert was young and he was offended at the time because his whole, you know, his art was being impeded on. And so the producer finally said to him, "All right, I'll tell you what. If you can tell me why you need to say shithead as opposed to anything else, if you think long and hard and give me a good artistic reason, then you can go ahead and keep it in there." And Ron Gilbert walked away and thought long and hard about it. And from that point on, he has not really sworn in his games because he realized that, you know, he was just doing it to be edgy and that there was no real reason for it. I've gone ahead and rung the doorbell so that Weird Ed can come down. And one of the interesting things about this is at certain points during the game, like when I ring the doorbell, for example, you see that the action cuts away to show the kids, or show the family members of the house. And this game is actually the game that coined the phrase cutscene. Okay, in that when they wrote the scripting engine for this game, which I'll probably talk about in more detail, and I'm going to bring all three kids up onto the porch. When they wrote the scripting engine for it, they actually made the command cutscene because it cut away from the main action of the game. And so, you know, hence cutscene. And from that day on, cutscene has been the developer's word for has, you know, for the cutscenes in games. So if we look around and pull the doormat, Bernard's kind of in the way there, but I gathered everyone up here. You can see that there is a key hidden underneath the mat. Whoops. And I want to give it to Razor. Oh no, actually, I don't know why I'm being so exacting about this. So Bernard's going to open the front door, but we're going to leave him on the porch for now. And we're going to have Razor and Dave go inside. Okay. So when you first start off the game, one of the earliest traps in the game, and this is sort of a funny st whoops. I want to be Dave. Dave. This is actually one of the funniest things about the game. Dave, although you have to take him along, is the least useful character in the game. The first time you enter the kitchen, you immediately run into Nurse Edna. And that is the original dialogue from the game. "I should have tied you to my bed," which was not allowed in the NES version. You know, which I think in the NES version, it was, "I have half a mind to call your parents," or something like that. So you end up locked in the dungeon, with the skeleton. And also the door to the secret lab is right here. Okay. But Once you're in the dungeon, one kid alone can't get out of the dungeon until much later. But because Dave is the most useless member of the group, I always sent Dave in to intercept. Oh, and here we have. Yeah, say, okay. Okay, that's interesting. I don't know, it ran fine for me. So we'll just go. That's kind of interesting. All right. There is actually a reason that I leave Bernard out on the porch. So now there's a couple of different things to note about having multiple kids. Like I said, there are a couple of different ways that you can actually play through the game, with the different kids. And in fact, you know what? Let's go ahead and save. Okay, so we'll have Bernard. Now I'm going to leave Bernard out on the porch for a second, because there's actually kind of a clue. When you ring the doorbell, Weird Ed, the son, whoops, use key with door. Weird Ed, the son, says, "Oh, I hope that's my package," indicating that he's waiting for a delivery. And I think I'm actually going to show it off. The other thing is that you can actually get away from Nurse Edna. As soon as you see her, you can run out the door. So you can escape her. Okay. So now we're not going to end up with a kid in the dungeon, which is just fine. Okay. So then enters... actually, I guess one of the interesting things about this game too was that it was one of the first games to have scrolling screens. Okay, so we're gonna go ahead and pick up this flashlight. I like Razor's reaction to the chainsaw. Interestingly enough, the chainsaw is a completely useless item. There is no gasoline for it. And then we see a couple of different things. There's a can of Pepsi, some old batteries, some cheese, moldy cheese. Oh, okay, and here's the first cutscene. Every so often, the game cuts away from you to show you what's going on in other parts of the mansion. And one of the interesting things is, as the villains move around the mansion, if they intercept your kids, they will capture them, which you eventually start using to your advantage. And this is also the first mention of the meteor. Which we, except for seeing it crash 20 years ago. Okay, so we're gonna, you know, and this starts the old, whoops. Okay, I forget, okay, so there's keyboard hotkeys. So I can get through this a little faster. So this starts the old sort of adventure game trope of pick up everything. Though there are many, many useless items in this game. What? This is actually a famous painting. I don't know what it's called though, but I do recognize it. So this is the dining room. the chair is bitchin'. That's, by the way, bitchin' is her generic response for stuff that she, yeah, that doesn't have any other sort of dialogue programmed. Joe Phantasm is pointing out Well, okay, now see, we have this cutscene here. And I think we accidentally left Dave in the whatchamacallit, the front hall, so we're gonna, since the game has developed a tendency to crash, we're gonna go ahead and so Joe Phantasm is pointing out that the painting is called A Sunday on La Grande Jetée, which is a Syrah, or a Syrah, sorry. Oh, and she drops the bottle of developer, and it spills on the grate, which is welded into the floor. Oh, no! I forgot Dave was there, and now he got captured. Because the villains are actually moving around the mansion in real time. That also is a clue, that too bad you're not on my side thing. Because it is possible to gain Weird Ed's friendship and have him help you. So, one of the things that adventure games like this in general have is this sort of, there's sort of three phases of play to the adventure game, when you get down to it. There's the sort of flailing about style of play, where when you first start out the game, you're wandering around, you're looking at everything. Cassette tapes. Remember those days. You can actually open the radio. And there's a radio tube in there. But Razor doesn't know how to take it out. Save Load Repeat is pointing out that the poster that Ed has in his room is actually the puzzle dependency chart for the game. That's actually not quite accurate. What that is was... Oh, that's a reference to Indiana Jones. What that was actually a hand-drawn map that was almost like a board game of the mansion, because it was before Gilbert had developed the idea of puzzle dependency charts. So what Gilbert and Winnick had actually done was to... Now we see we can use the flashlight and then turn on the lamp. What Winnick and Gilbert had actually done was to draw a map of the mansion on a big piece of poster board. Whoops. A big piece of poster board, and then, like, they would move tokens around it to actually play out different portions of the game to make sure that, that it could be played properly. That did eventually become the idea of the puzzle dependency chart, but again, Gilbert and Winnick were really flailing around when they started with this game. The phone we see is broken, and this is Chuck the Plant, which is completely useless in this game, but the reason he was included was because there was a guy named Chuck who worked at LucasArts. And every time someone was developing a game, this guy Chuck would ask someone to write him into the game. And, I want to look at the cassette tape. Okay, so now we have a cassette tape. And so finally Gilbert acquiesced by writing in Chuck the Plant, which was basically just a plant. The chat is commenting on how the staircase can be out of order now, how a staircase can be out of order. That's because that staircase doesn't actually lead anywhere, and that staircase was actually based on a spiral staircase in the library of the Lucasfilm, or in of the Skywalker Ranch main house. In the original Commodore 64 version, this steel security door was copy protection, where you had to put in a particular keypad code to get into it, and you couldn't proceed any further. But, so now we're wandering around, and this is the painting room. Where we see a bowl of wax fruit, which we'll take, and a paintbrush, which we'll take, and paint remover, which we'll take. And you'll also see it looks like somebody was painting a sphere, and there is a trail of purple slime leading out the door. And Razor is not going to touch that slime. Razor is a klepto. Yeah, it's an adventure game. Everybody is a klepto. So, like I said, I was talking about, like, the first phase, which I call the flailing around phase, or I guess it might be more sort of the appropriately called the exploration phase, is where you're learning where everything is, and I like the bloodstains on the wall of the music room. And we have a cassette recorder here, and a Victrola. And we'll go ahead and pick up the radio. And as you're doing it, like, occasionally you'll see items you can interact with right away. And, you know, you'll try them out. But for the most part, you really don't know what you're doing. Is it actually playing? Okay. Yeah, it is actually playing. And we can also look at the TV. This is actually an important plot point. Darabim says Razor has no encumbrance system. None of the kids do. It, again, standard adventure game logic. And later on, later adventure games from Lucasfilms kind of made fun of this. I should talk a little bit about the whole verb thing, because that was another interesting thing. When Gilbert and Winnick were first developing this game, they had kind of a vague idea for this game. They had sort of a vague idea for this game where, Citroën Envoyés. Save Load and Repeat is pointing out that the record is from the Loom soundtrack, and it is also Swan Lake. Wow, it's, Save Load and Repeat is as much of an expert in this game as I am. Very nice. This statue, by the way, was cut from the NES version. And it was almost left in. But, so anyway, In the original version of this game, these dark rooms were actually completely dark in that you could not see anything at all, not even faded out. Whoops. Ah, son of a bitch. Are the cutscenes gonna crash this every time? Where did I save last? I don't understand why. I did a perfect run through of this game with no crashes or issues to make sure this would be okay. Okay. Save, Load, Repeat translated the French. If it says, if you find this, please send it back to the Louvre. Actually, there's a funny thing with that statue being cut from the NES version, because... Okay, I'm just gonna... Alright, so we did get kicked back a bit. I'm just gonna have to save very frequently. Alright, I don't have to look back at everything again. Oh, though... You'll notice that there is a key up there on the chandelier, but we can't get that yet. And that's part of the whole flailing around thing, is discovering all the things that you can't do anything with. Pick up. Discovering all the things that you can't do anything with and then coming back for them later. And I should also point out that all the music in this version of the game was lifted from the sequel to this game, Day of the Tentacle. Oh, Demistic showed up and he wants me to repeat everything that he missed. Well, if the game keeps crashing, I might. Anywho, I do have to actually watch the TV again, because you do have to learn the address from the TV. Thanks, Save, Load, Repeat. Thanks for stopping by, and hope I'll see you again soon. So anyway, the whole verb thing. When they were originally developing this game, they hadn't quite decided on what genre of game it was going to be. They had an idea for a game based on kids rescuing their friend from a mansion, and they had the idea of a meteor, which was based on... I did save. So, which was actually based on a Stephen King movie. It was actually based on Creepshow. But they didn't know what genre it was going to be. So I'm just going to keep talking while I look around the things, because I'm looking at the things as... This is Dr. Fred's office, by the by. That weekend, or one weekend, this is the manuscript. That weekend, Gary Winnick, when he was visiting family, and I think it was his nephew, was playing the first King's Quest game. And the first King's Quest game, while it was a graphical adventure in that you could move around on graphics, as opposed to, like, you know, the text-based games like Zork and Great Cave Adventure and stuff, it still had a text parser where you still had to, you know, type in what you wanted to do, like pick up bush or, you know, get sword or whatever. And he was becoming very frustrated with the game, Gary Winnick was, because he said that most of the time he was trying to second guess the parser and figure out what words had been programmed into it. And he said, why can't we just have a system where you see the verbs on the... Oh, that's interesting. They actually cut... Alright. So this is the arcade room. And there's not much we can do in here just yet. But, so ultimately the idea came for, you know, just having these, you know, the verbs that you could click right on the screen. And that was that, you know? So, and that was what invented the text. Oh, and here is Green Tentacle. Now, Green Tentacle demands food. Interestingly enough, Bernard is a coward, and if you bring Bernard up here first, he will run away. So we'll try giving him the old rotten turkey. And now he wants more food. So we'll give him the roast. Shazba says, having played Zork, she thinks that's a great idea. Whoops. Oh wait, didn't we pick up a bag of tentacle chow? Maybe he wants the tentacle chow. Or did I not grab it? Oh, I think I forgot to grab the stuff from the, That's okay, we'll be back down there. Here, have some lettuce. And this puzzle is actually a bit of a joke that was programmed in, because in the end, the item that you have to give the Green Tentacle is the wax fruit. That's what finally satisfies him. And that was a joke. I mean, it was It was a gag that they wrote in because it's the one item in your inventory that actually isn't useful food. Oh. That's funny. In the and I didn't grab the fruit drink, so we gotta run back downstairs. In the NES version, if you tried to give him the can of Pepsi, he would take it and say, "Wow, that's a lot. I can't finish it." And then he would give you back the can of Pepsi, but he would also let you pass. In the Commodore 64 version, by the way, this grandfather clock was actually the first item they animated in the game. Just weird fun fact. Derubim says, "How can the tentacle not like Pepsi?" He was very clear. He said it makes him burp. Okay, so yeah, I had not picked up this stuff, and you know what? It's been minutes since my last save. So, whoops. Oh, darn it, I dropped the bottle of developer. I need the glass jar, and I need the fruit drinks. Chasba says probably burping was not appropriate for Nintendo. Oh, I forgot the statue story. Right, so it was actually a rather famous story, and you can actually read a whole thing online. It's called The Expurgation of Maniac Mansion, about all of the things that who is that a picture of? I don't know. About all the things that Nintendo of America forced them to remove from this game. And one of them was that Nintendo objected to that nude statue. But... Whoops. Another cutscene. And this is where we sort of get insight into the whole family... the family life of... So that... This is Weird Ed Edison and Nurse Edna Edison, the son and wife of Dr. Fred Edison. This is actually an interesting one, too. Nintendo objected to this cutscene. Because Weird Ed says that he's worried about his dad because he hasn't eaten in years and because he's been bringing those bodies home. So Nintendo of America objected to that scene because it implied that Dr. Fred was a cannibal and that he was eating the corpses. I shit you not. So anyway, the whole statue thing, because I keep... So this is a photo developing room. You'll probably remember that one of the characters was a photographer. So, anyway, they tried to cut the statue of the nude. Ron Gilbert insisted, no, you can't do that. It's not... It's actually a classical statue. It's a real statue. Even though it really wasn't, they had just drawn that statue. And so Gary Winnick, I think, ended up looking through numerous art textbooks until he could find a statue that looked exactly like that to bring to Nintendo and say, "No, see, this is classical artwork." Kind of tough to hit the dime. Okay. Okay, now that is the wanted poster for the slimy purple meteor. So, the actual secret is that, that there is a slimy purple meteor that is in the basement that Dr. Fred is in cahoots with. We also find out that the green tentacle is a rocker. a very depressed rocker. A stress-eating depressed rocker. Oh, Derubim said your cursor cannot stop on a dime. We also get this record of tentacle mating calls. So we'll go ahead and take that right now. And that's a reference to Ron Gilbert, who wrote the game. Nintendo actually made a real mess out of it. One of the other things, and I'm surprised they cut it from this version, one of the video games in the... And I'm actually going to skip these two bedrooms for just a moment, using my knowledge of the game. One of the video games in the arcade room was actually called Muff Diver. And obviously, Nintendo objected to that one. So it was ultimately changed to Tuna Diver. Though it seems to have been completely removed from this version of the game. This room belongs to dead cousin Ted. Who... that's a bitchin' sarcophagus. Who sleeps in a sarcophagus with a pillow. Rogue Rena. Oh, hi, Rogue Rena! Says using knowledge of the game isn't that cheating. Yeah, it is a little bit, but... I mean, all it would do is... I would just end up walking back here. So, this is the Hunk-O-Matic machine. And you can actually use it. It's basically a weightlifting machine. And it doesn't tell you much about it. But the secret is that it actually makes you stronger. So that there are certain things that you can now do in the game. Yep, sexy mummy pinup. Okay. We'll pick up the sponge. The cracked mirror is bitchin'. The sink is a sink. Obviously, you can try to use the toilet. She won't do that, but you can. Whoops. Alright. See, we're almost done with the flailing around portion, though. So now let's open the shower curtain, and whoop! There's dead cousin Ted. And... we can't do anything with him just yet. He's just in the way, but he is preventing us from seeing everything that's written on the back wall. Shazba says, I'm so glad Razor looks in the mirror and says, bitchin'. Razor looks at everything and says bitchin', though. I don't think that's, like, means anything about her. So the plant... I mean, the plant is bitchin'. An antique typewriter. Oops. Okay. Now, the doorbell has rung. And it is very important that you beat Weird Ed to the package. You can actually, with certain combinations of kids, if you fail to do this right, you can render the game unwinnable. And now we'll... Oh, Bernard can just wait here. And that is why I left Bernard at the front door. This is the man-eating plant. And if we look at the wall here, we'll notice that there's a paint blotch all over the wall, and maybe we think to use our paint remover on the paint blotch. Oh, use the paint brush with the paint remover. Shazba is saying, and I'm not sure what she's reacting to because of the delay in the stream. Let me save, by the way. I don't remember having to do all of these steps. Okay, and we noticed that there was actually a door that was painted over. And now we're here in the attic. Whoops. Now these old batteries will die. They don't last very long, as was implied. Oh, she was reacting to the whispering plant. Okay. So now we can go into these other rooms. And this first bedroom here, this bedroom belongs to Weird Ed. Okay? And what we're actually going to do, so that I don't have to do this again and again, is we can draw Weird Ed out of his room by ringing the doorbell, because he's waiting for his package. If he has picked up his package, by the way, then he won't respond to the doorbell. So we'll switch back to Razor. We'll give him a second to clear that hall. And now we can quickly. Now we have a limited amount of time to do this, so we can grab his hamster and his card key, which was under the hamster. We can open the piggy bank, and we can pick up the dimes in his piggy bank. And now we can get out of here. Derubim, I'm sorry to tell you, the hamster has a very, very, very poor fate. Okay. Now at this point, we no longer need Bernard outside, so we can let him come in. Oh, I forgot, by the way. So you can actually pull on the bushes and reveal a grating. But the grating is rusted shut. Only somebody who's really strong can open it. And that is with the hunk-o-matic machine. So whichever kid worked out with the hunk-o-matic, is strong enough then to open the grate. Meanwhile, the second room is the room that belongs to Nurse Edna. And obviously, if you walk in here, you immediately get captured and brought down to the dungeon. And that is what Nurse Edna says when she captures a girl. Now, once you have two kids in the dungeon, you can actually get one kid out of the dungeon because there is a loose brick in the wall. And if you push the loose brick, it opens the door as long as that kid stays in front of it. If the kid moves out from in front of the loose brick, the door closes. So as long as you have one person in the dungeon, you can always get out again, which is why I leave Dave down there. And now we can see that we're in the basement. And this is where things get a little bit weird. I'm stuck behind the stuff. So there's radioactive slime in the basement, and a furnace, and a nuclear reactor. Where's the light switch? There we go. Chernobyl. Okay, so now I'm gonna save here. And we're going to demonstrate one of the game over states. Okay, so these are the circuit breakers. And if you turn off the circuit breakers, there is now no coolant to the nuclear reactor. O-Dog says, this is where it gets weird. Yeah, the nuclear reactor in the basement is kind of where it gets strange. Any minute now, a cutscene is going to come in. Right? I don't know why the cutscene is not kicking in. Usually what happens... There's usually a cutscene. Derebim says, run, Razor! Ahoy, Tagrath! I don't know why the mansion is not melting down. Basically, if you leave the power off... Huh. Alright, well, I don't know. I don't know why I'm not getting the game over. Alright, well, either way. Imagine that there is a horrible nuclear meltdown and it destroys everything in a 5-mile radius, including all 3 kids and the mansion. Okay. So now we've pretty much explored most of the mansion. Oh, wait, except for... Now, because Razor worked out on the hunk-o-matic machine, she can open the grating and get underneath the house. And this is the puddle of developing fluid that soaked down from the... from that grating up above. And there's also a water valve here. Okay, here we go. So I'm going to go ahead and save the game here. This should be okay. The water valve cuts off the coolant to the nuclear reactor. There we go. I like that line. How can I take over the world when I'm on a budget? I think after I finish Sonic, I'm going to come back and do the sequel to this one. It's fully voice acted. It involves time travel. It is hilarious. Shazba and Derebin both point out that he's referring to another meltdown. That, by the way, is Purple Tentacle. So we're just going to go ahead and leave the pool drained for now. There is actually a pool in the backyard. Whoops. Oh, he turned off the lights! I guess because, you know, it's important to be a green villain. I'm also going to go ahead and reveal another thing here while we're waiting for the kill screen. But there is no way to get down into the basement from this side unless you push this gargoyle. And then as long as a kid stands in front of the gargoyle and doesn't move, another kid can skedoodle through into the basement. Skedoodle being a word. I don't really want to waste time solving any puzzles since we're about to have a kill screen, and I do want to show the kill screen at least once. Though actually, it's always the same kill screen, so I'm going to go ahead and close it. Oh, there we go. Game over. Which, by the way, that is not a meltdown, that is an explosion. Which is actually very rare for a nuclear reactor. Reactors don't usually explode. So for right now, we're going to go ahead and leave the pool alone. And now... actually, I'm just going to run out to the backyard. And then we're going to start solving some puzzles. Now that we've explored the whole mansion, except for one room, which is Nurse Edna's room. The chat is claiming moral victory because the meteor was destroyed in the explosion. So this, by the way, is the pool. Razor doesn't want to get wet. And can't get to the radio, but it is bitchin'. But what we will do is we will get a jar of radio of water. Now, the game doesn't explicitly... Oh, this one does. The game does explicitly say it's radioactive. Because the pool is actually being used to cool the nuclear fuel rods. And now, also the kid who worked out with the hunk-o-matic is the one that can... I don't have the key to the car yet. That, by the way, is an Edsel. That is the weird Edsel. And it actually has a pair of rocket engines on it. I didn't get the key. Why am I... I don't remember where the key is. Oh, and I need the key. Alright, I think... I want to say the key is up in the tentacles room. So now we've pretty much explored the whole mansion. We've gotten the lay of the land. And now we enter the second... Oh, actually, here we go. Another quick one. Let's see. If we open the microwave and use the radioactive water in the microwave and close the microwave and then turn the microwave on, now, this is interesting because she ends up with a tombstone in the, if a kid gets killed, you end up with a tombstone out here. But in this version, the deluxe version, they actually added this safety feature where you can pick up all of their items. It is actually possible in most cases to beat the game with just one kid. There are a few exceptions. And in the original game, you actually couldn't... you actually didn't get the stuff of the kid who died. So once a kid died, if they died with anything vital, and they did, that was the end of it. So here's another thing that got snuck into the game. And it was actually snuck in by the engine coder, who was playing around, and he's laughing. I can't remember who it was on the team. And he finally, one day, he called Gary Winnick and Ron Gilbert into his office, and he said, guys, come here, look at this. And he puts the hamster in the microwave, and then he says, okay, check this out. And then he turns the microwave on. And then you actually end up with the item... Did I pick it up? Pick up exploded hamster. Razor has a really... That's a creepy response by Razor. I like the graphic. So you can blow up the hamster. I have to run upstairs and get the key to the car. Now, the thing is, because each kid has a couple of special puzzles only they can solve, and there are certain puzzles that are required to beat the game, there's sort of a there was a lot of ways to dead-end the game. I swear the key was in here, isn't it? Yeah, there it is. Okay, there's the key to the Edsel. Yeah, I can't believe I forgot that. Because I need the tools. So, you know, once you kill the kid, you usually ended up having to restart. And that was something that, that Ron Gilbert always kind of regretted. Shazba says, and Bernard just watches this lady throw a hamster in a microwave and kill it and cram it in her pockets. She's a punk rocker. Ozzy Osbourne bit the head off a bat. She could microwave a hamster. All right, so now we're going to have her run out. We're going to have her go run out to the car. Whoops. Okay. And this is another spot where you can sort of render the game potentially unwinnable. If you use the yellow key in the car, you start the car, and it takes off. And unfortunately, it took off with an item that you need to... Actually, yeah, an item that you need to win the game. So the key is open the trunk and pick up the tools. All right. Now we're going to start actually solving some puzzles here. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to get into the pool because we want to get the radio and get anything else that is underneath the pool. And this is one of the... and this is one of the... Actually, the game is neat in that it uses... It has a lot of puzzles that are solved with two characters. Also, I'm going to remember to try and open the package. Because if you don't get the stamps, then you're kind of screwed. Okay. So what we're going to do, and we have to work fast, because if we don't finish this in time, the water... we know that... Whoops. Open water valve. So now the pool is drained... And Razor can get to the bottom, and she can pick up the glowing key, and she can... Whoop. And... And we can open the radio. Whoop. We can pick up the radio. And I'm just going to save here. And there is also this mysterious button down here. So we can... Whoops. Yeah, yeah. So we can go ahead and push the red button. And that blows up the mansion. Why? I don't know. Also, oh, here's the other thing. If we, since I did just save... Yep. Shazma says, why would you have that button? We can also drown Razor by refilling the pool. But we're going to go ahead and get her out. And then Bernard then we have to quickly close the valve. Otherwise the mansion will melt down. Derebim says I'm really being mean to Razor. I'm resurrecting her every goddamn time, so don't start with me, man. Okay. So now let's bring the two of them together, and it's time to start solving some actual puzzles. Because once you've explored the whole mansion, actually beating the game, except for the fact that basically you're solving a bunch of point-click adventure game puzzles, so you have to deal with all this, you know, incredibly bullshit moon logic. So we are going to give the tools to Bernard, and Bernard is going to give the stamps to Razor. And now, meanwhile, yeah, I know, I keep saying now we'll solve puzzles. Well, I kind of forgot to get some stuff. Okay. Okay, so first we're going to send Bernard to go fix the phone, which was broken. And this is Bernard's unique skill. Bernard and actually Jeff are the only ones who can fix the phone. Bernard is also the only kid who can get the radio tube out of the radio. Those are his unique skills, and those lead to his unique way of getting into the secret lab. Because every kid has a unique... not unique way of getting into the secret lab. There's basically four steps that you need to beat this game. You need to get past the outer security door. I want to keep him by the phone. Then you need to get past the inner security door. Then you need to deal with Purple Tentacle. And then you need to deal with the meteor. And the different kids have different ways of doing that. So for example, right now, we can get past the green tentacle either by getting the green tentacle to help us, green tentacle to help us, or by calling the meteor police. The other thing that we can do is, so we can befriend green tentacle, or we can call the meteor police. And we can either use the meteor police to deal with the meteor, or we can, I can show off all of these because there's not too much difference except at the very end. So by feeding the radioactive water to the plant, we make the plant grow. But we can't climb the plant because the plant will bite Razor. Unless we give him the Pepsi to satisfy him. Oh, also, I guess I should get the batteries out. Okay. Because here's the other thing, is that there are broken electrical wires here. Oh, Bernard has the tools downstairs. All right, we'll come back for that. So now we can climb up here. I didn't really want to climb up here just yet, but there's a telescope here. So we can look at the telescope, and right now we're looking at the tree. We can put in a dime into the coin slot to rotate the telescope. And I'm going to tell you, this is one of the... There are a lot of really crappy puzzles in this game. Okay? To be totally honest, as I said, this game is kind... Oh, I forgot what I was coming up here to do. Just to be totally honest... A lot of this shit is just not intuitive at all. And ultimately... okay. So I have the shower handle now. Speaking of non-intuitive things. Didn't I get a shower handle? Yeah. Oh, there it is. So now we can... And... Dead Cousin Ted doesn't want to get wet. So he slides over out of the water, and now we get Edna's phone number, 3444. So now... Yeah, Demistic says puzzle in a point-and-click adventure game often means guessing what the devs thought would be funny. And that is true. Meanwhile, we're going to give Edna a call. Darabim says Edna wrote that in her own bathroom. Actually, that is dead cousin Ted's bathroom, which is why it was handicapped accessible, because he's a mummy. Going to go ahead and let this scene speak for itself. But while she is distracted on the phone, we can come into her room and pick up the key on the nightstand and walk up the stairs to the attic. Okay. And there is actually a number written underneath the safe that is too tiny to read. If only we had some way of magnifying it. So now we're going to climb back down. Wow, Edna is still on the phone, huh? And now we can go ahead and use a dime in the coin slot. And you only have 4 dimes. And we're going to rotate the telescope to the right. Now we can see the corner of the house, but that's still not quite what we're looking for. So we'll go ahead and use 1 more dime with the coin slot. Okay. And now we can see that the combination to the safe is 0120. Yeah. All right. We'll have Bernard make another call to Edna. I also like how it kind of, because it knows you're going to do that multiple times, it shortens the dialogue a little bit. I forgot the combination. What was it? 0122? Son of a bitch. Does anybody in the stream remember the combination? Do I have to actually roll the stream back? I do, don't I? 0120. 0120. Used to play these games with a little piece of notepaper around. Okay, and now we have a sealed envelope. Alright. Now we're done with Edna. Okay. Now the other thing is that we have those broken wires. And so actually what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to let Edna nab me. Wait, hold on. Do I have the package? No, okay. We're just going to go ahead and save here. Yeah. See, the game gives you just a minute here, because if you have Weird Ed's package, you can... Oh, okay. So if you give him the exploded hamster, he will murder you. If you give him the package, though, you gain his friendship. And actually with Michael, who can develop his film, because then he reveals that he needs some film developed. So with Michael, I need to get nabbed. I need to get back in the, I guess I can get back into the basement this way. Oh, all right. While I'm down here though. So I've got this blank cassette tape and I've got a phonograph of tentacle mating calls. So if we play the tentacle mating calls, whoops, another cutscene. Oh, I forgot about this. This is a pain in the ass now, because with the power off, you can't do anything that requires electricity, and the whole mansion is dark. Alright. So, wait, maybe I can get this done in time. So it makes this horrible squealing noise. And now I'm recording a copy of that onto this blank cassette. Yeah, Rogue Rena is pointing out that there is definitely a lot of family problems in this particular family. So meanwhile, with the power out, that'll kind of make things easier. Because now the power is going to get shut off. Whoops. But if we go ahead and now play that piercing, shrill note. We can break all the glass, including the glass chandelier that had the key on it. Now, meanwhile, we're going to send Bernard upstairs. Whoops. He needs the flashlight, though. We're going to put the good batteries in the flashlight. Derubim says, "See, I would have thought ladder, not horrible screeching mating call to break the chandelier." Oh, see, another hint. That's what the card key was underneath the hamster. All right. So I'm gonna give Bernard the flashlight, and Bernard also has the tools. So we're gonna send him upstairs now. And this is the other thing. I'm gonna show off both endings that I can get with these two kids, because at this point it's actually very quick now to finish the game once you have most of the components. Yeah. Or once you have all the components. So we're going to send Bernard up here. Meanwhile, we are going to forge an alliance with the green tentacle. And the way that works is like this. We know that he wants to start a band, right? So, the first thing we do is, I guess I should save here. Shazpa, I would run that game for you. Oops, okay, now the power went out. Okay, so, because Dr. Fred said he was going to turn off the power. So with the power out, which we could either turn off ourselves, or... Oh, he turned it right back on, huh? The power came back on in a hurry. Alright, we'll have to do it ourselves. But the first thing we're going to do... Whoops. Is start the cassette recorder recording. Razor and Sid are both capable of performing, playing this, playing on the piano, and recording a really good song. And they can actually get a recording contract by sending the, by sending their demo tape to Marketeer, the guy on the TV. But if you then show that recording contract to the Green Tentacle gets jealous and murders you. Okay. Meanwhile, that's a hint there. With those this game starts to move in a hurry, huh? All right. I'll come back to that stupid cutscene in a second. Because now what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and befriend Green Tentacle. I'm actually going to lay the groundwork for both endings. Okay. So if instead... Oh, good grief. I forgot that as the game goes on, the cutscenes become more and more frequent. Nintendo also objected to this cutscene. Shazba asks, are the cutscenes based on time or actions performed? They're actually based on both. Some of the cutscenes are triggered by specific events in the game, some of them are triggered by timers, and some of them are triggered by timers that are started by specific events in the game. Ron Gilbert also says that there are fail-safes to prevent cutscenes from triggering in ways that would screw up the game or make them impossible. So we're going to show Green Tentacle the demo tape. Oh, I should play it in his stereo. Oh, he's gonna. So now Green Tentacle has dropped his demo tape, which we can then listen to. And it's actually not too bad. So what we're going to do... It does seem bitchin', right, Shazba? So what we're going to do is, remembering that there are three guys who publish anything, we are going to go ahead and mail them Green Tentacle's demo tape. Derubim says that's some serious talent for a creature with no limbs or thumbs. And this is another one of the ways to render the game unwinnable, particularly if you're playing the game with Sid and Razor, because both Sid and Razor have to take the same steps. Okay? So you have this envelope, this sealed envelope from Dr. Fred's... from Dr. Fred's safe. And if you rip it open, you won't be able to reuse it again, and it's the only envelope in the game. So the key is to steam it open using the microwave. Okay. The other thing is that if you give Weird Ed the, and there was a quarter inside the envelope. So now we're going to put his demo tape inside the envelope. And now we need to address it, and you'll remember that there is a, and as I've pointed out, it is actually possible to beat this game with actually two kids dead. You can actually kill off Dave, because he's completely useless, and you can get rid of one other kid, and as And every other kid in the game can beat the entire game except for Jeff. Because Jeff does not have a way to get into the lab. And then because we took the stamps off of Weird Ed's package, now we have a complete I guess I should save again. Malinchop is asking if they made any substantial changes to this game, or is it just a visual update? It is entirely a visual and audio update. The game, the script is still the same. It was actually based on the original Scum script. So we'll open the mailbox, put the flag up, and then we wait. Well, I guess now we do want to wait out here. Derebim says, as someone whose name is David, this is bumming me out. I'm really sorry, man. Okay, so now you can see that the mail has been collected. And now we wait for the doorbell to ring. And that will tell us... Oh, here we go. It is possible to send in a lot of different things. You can send a recording of the tentacle mating calls, which will break the glass windows and his glasses. You can send in the manuscript that you found in the upstairs, which is actually the Purple Tentacle's memoirs, which are really, really crappy. But if you have Wendy rewrite the memoirs and edit them, she'll fix them, and then the tentacle will get a recording, or the purple meteor will actually get a publishing contract. Okay. So now we can grab the mail, and we have a recording contract for Green Tentacle. Meanwhile, the other thing we need to do is actually get down into the basement. Oh, and I think I now have the key to the basement, right? One of these keys opens the basement door, doesn't it? I could be wrong on that. I think I'm wrong. I don't think there's actually a key to the basement. Shazba says all of these solutions are amazing. This game is amazing, and it did... One of the other things that it did uniquely was that it did have all of the different solutions to the game. O-Dog said, why did the doorbell ring when the mail arrives? Because that's how it works. Alright, so I need to get down to the basement in a hurry. And the easiest way to do that is to just go see Nurse Edna. And we are just about in a position to finish this game now. The glowing key unlocks the padlocks. And then we see that there is a second door inside the first, which requires a passcode, but we don't have that passcode yet. But now that we're here in the basement, whoops, we can have Dave push the loose brick. Whoops. To let Razor out. And late Razor can turn off the fuse box, which will cut the power so that Bernard can fix these broken wires. Rogue Renna says, poor Dave. It's okay. Dave gets the cheerleader in the end. It is his girlfriend that they're trying to save. So now, now there was a clue here, and I'm gonna save because sometimes I screw this up a little bit. But if you now play the Meteor Mess game, Dr. Fred has a high score, DFE, 5858. And that is actually the passcode to the inner door, which is why he wanted to play the game. So now the lab is open. Now we have two obstacles left in front of us. Okay? One, Shazba says, are you kidding me? Nope, I kid you not. That's how you do it. So now there's two different solutions to the game. And we're going to do the let's do the Meteor Police solution to the game first. Okay, so the Meteor Police solution to the game. I'm going to put Razor in the dungeon. Once you have both doors to the lab open, if you have Bernard in your group, and Bernard is the only one who can do this, Bernard can use the radio tube to fix the broken radio, and then if you read the wanted poster, it gives us the phone number for the Meteor Police. 0525. Meanwhile, I'm gonna go ahead and give Dave the card key. Because we're gonna let Dave win the game, since he spent the whole rest of the game in the dungeon. So, what was that? 0525? 0525. So we're going to go ahead and call the Meteor Police. The murderous purple meteor. Now, I don't think it actually takes 5 minutes. Comedy! I left the flashlight on. The flashlight will now stay on indefinitely. So the Meteor Police should be here in just a minute. I'm trying to think, I guess while I'm waiting, I'll walk up to Weird Ed's room. Because you can actually turn Weird Ed non-hostile. Oh, here we go. And he just teleports in there. Ignores the purple tentacle. I like how the purple tentacle drips slime when he talks. That's like his talking animation. And then he's teleported away. And he leaves the Meteor Police badge. I'm going to go ahead and save over number two, because I want to be able to come back with Razor's ending. So now the purple tentacle will stop us. Unless we give him the Meteor Police badge, because then he panics. That got dark fast, huh? I also love the little sucker noise that they added to the green tentacle. Alright, so now we come in and we have the final confrontation. Okay. And now you have 2 minutes to solve this last problem. And the last problem is to go over here, put on the radiation suit. Whoops. Use the key card in the card slot. Go through here and turn off the machine that has been controlling Dr. Fred's brain. Jasper just said, oh! O-Dog says, because that was obvious. Derubim said it would have been nice if there was a hint he was being controlled. Actually, there were implications that he was not in his right. Who the hell am I kidding? You just kept trying till you got it right. But now we're going to go back in time a little bit. And we're going to do the alternative ending. I did open the lab door, right? Okay. In this ending, we are not going to call the meteor police. This is actually Razor's ending. So Razor got a recording contract with the Green Tentacle. Or for the Green Tentacle. So we're going to go ahead and give him the recording contract. O-Dog says, how did people solve these games before the internet? Melanichop says, trial and error. That's exactly it. And I'm going to end this with a little soliloquy. Ron Gilbert sort of soliloquy. I don't know why I'm saying soliloquy. Okay, so now that I've befriended the Green Tentacle, though, I need to hustle down to the... So Green Tentacle will now get us past the Purple Tentacle, but he will not get rid of the meteor for us. So in order to get rid of the meteor, we're going to have to do something a little bit different this time around. So again, we're going to let Dave play the hero. And we're going to make sure that Dave has what he needs. And in this case, he's going to need the key card and the car key. So now Dave is going to go in Green Tentacle was supposed to come and help. That's weird. Oh, Derubim says, did you ever give the package to Ed? No, I didn't, but I kind of screwed that up. Oh, I think. Oh, wait, there it is. Okay. No, Darabim, I didn't give the package to Ed. All that does is make Ed not hostile, which actually makes things a little bit trickier because then you can't ransack his room. It's only if you have Michael, who can develop his film, that you can actually befriend Ed, and then Ed will come down here and do what the green tentacle just did, and that is to say, get rid of purple tentacle so that we can get into the lab. So now this will sort of play out the same way. Alright, I'm gonna go ahead and skip the cutscene here. Since we already know. So now again, get into the radiation suit. If you go in here without the radiation suit, the radiation will kill you. And now, we can't use the switch because of the purple meteor. Whoops. Oh, damn it. What did I do wrong? Oh, okay, I gotta turn off the switch first. But that still does not take care of the purple meteor. So now, we take the purple meteor, put the purple meteor in the trunk, close the trunk, start the car. I clicked in the wrong spot. Start the car. Hi, RL Richie. Yeah, this game is Maniac Mansion. It's an adventure game I wrote about in my most recent article on Everything's an Adventure. And I thought I would just be fun to show a playthrough of it, especially because it's kind of funny. Malinichop says you can dispose of the meteor by throwing it in the pool or feeding it to the plant. I actually did not know that. So, thank you for that. I had no idea. So, as I said, you know, this is, Ron Gilbert has kind of admitted that this game was not the most well-designed puzzle game. That it had some definite failures to it. And he eventually came up with, and I'm going to share this just as sort of an end note. Sorry for the inception there. Okay, he eventually wrote this entry on his blog called Why Adventure Games Suck. And I hope that's still coming through on the stream, okay? Yeah, okay, good. Okay, it's called Why Adventure Games Suck. And it was a list of basically the mistakes that had been made that were since corrected after Maniac Mansion, especially in the Monkey Island series, which is where Ron Gilbert's rules of thumb really became clear. So the first thing he... And I'm just going to go through the rules. You can go ahead and read this on your own at some point. I'll go ahead and put a link in the description. But these are these are absolutely things where Maniac Mansion totally failed. End objective needs to be clear. From the beginning of the game, it is not clear the steps you need to take to actually rescue Sandy and finish the game. Sub goals need to be obvious. And for that same reason, it is not clear what goals you need to accomplish. The two doors and the purple tentacle and the purple meteor. Live and learn. In this rule, it says it should be possible to play through the game from beginning to end without getting killed just by figuring things out. It basically no trial and error gameplay. Backwards puzzles I've talked about in the past. That's what my rule of thumb is. Never always show the lock before you give the players the key. The I forgot to pick it up rule don't have puzzles that are dependent on items that you can never pick up, that you can miss and never get picked up again. Puzzles should advance the story. The Myst series is especially guilty of this, where it was basically just a delivery mechanism for puzzles that had no reason to exist in the world. And that's absolutely a good rule for D&D game masters. Real time is bad drama. Not really sure what that... okay. If you're going to run on a clock, you have to make sure that you have fail safes in place. Incremental rewards. As the player is succeeding at things, they have to know that they're succeeding. It's important to always tell them that they are, you know, that they are making progress and make progress obvious. Don't be arbitrary. Things have to make sense. Obviously, Maniac Mansion missed a lot of that. Rewarding intent, which is figuring out what the player is trying to do and then rewarding that, so that the player doesn't have to try and second guess the system. That is absolutely an important rule for a game master, is understand what it is your players are trying to accomplish, not the actions themselves. Unconnected events. That is, the player should always be able to connect the consequences of the action with the action itself. Don't have them do one thing that causes something else to happen that nobody could figure out that the one thing led to the other. And finally, make sure that there are multiple options, which I think we can all agree is definitely good advice for DMing. So I'm going to put a link to that in the description when I put this on YouTube. It's at grumpygamer.com, which is Ron Gilbert's blog, and it's under the title Why Adventure Games Suck. But so that's Maniac Mansion, and